Shalom, greetings to all and all. Selamta, Inest Ling. This is Ras Alonso Tafar reporting for the Lion of the Tribe of Judah Society of His Imperial Majesty, Haile Selassie I, and His Christ Jesus, HaMashiach, Yeshua. For the record, this day is Sunday, May 28th, and 2017, and it is 11:35 a.m. Now the following work that we are to present, we do or we bring forth on the basis that to do what we can is to do what we must. If ones can perform it better, then by all means, feel free to do so. Now, a few key points, disclaimers, not really, but you know, something of that nature. The following text that we are to read, we must make mention that the names in Amharic, the Amharic names, the pronunciation of them cannot be assured that we will do it as accurately as it would have been possible if the names would have been provided for in the Amharic text or in the Amharic language. That is, we do not know the vowel system, the pointing on the vowel system that is utilized, which includes the English alphabet. And so we are sure that the pronunciation of Amharic names will not be precise and exact. So let this be a warning to the listener. And to continue, we make mention that we are not professional readers. As a matter of fact, we did not begin to read up until the age of possibly 25, and we are now 30, and that is because we were called to Rastafari. We were called to Christ in light of Rastafari. Until that time, we had no interest in reading. To add to this, we learned to speak and speak mostly Spanish our whole lives to this very day. Therefore, you know, if ones could do it better, by all means, bring it forth. And I just do what we can, and that is to do what we must. Chapter 23, about our treaty with Italy concerning port facilities at Assab, the construction of a road, and general amity. We were frequently distressed about the fact that it was an obstacle to civilization that our country lacked a seaport of her own, particularly since Ethiopia entered the League of Nations and contacts with governments of the world had greatly expanded. We became convinced of the need to find an outlet to the sea. We therefore requested Italy to make available for us port facilities in the Assab region. Furthermore, we had been reminding the French minister at Addis Ababa from time to time of our desire to obtain access to the sea in the Djibouti area. The reasons why we were considering obtaining a seaport at Djibouti were, in the first place, that when the French government originally seized Djibouti, it was by agreement with Ethiopia, and in the second place, that it was a French company that built the railway under a concession from the Ethiopian government connecting us to Djibouti. Later, in 1916, that's to say 1924, when we came to visit Paris at the invitation of the French government, we disclosed to M. Poincaré, the then Prime Minister, that it was our desire to obtain access to the sea in the Djibouti area. He had given us a hopeful reply, but when after our return to our country, we repeatedly requested the French government to confirm the expectation given to us. They kept us waiting for about 2 years with several excuses and without giving a firm decision. The Italian government, however, were not pleased at our discussions with France about obtaining an outlet to the sea. Afterwards, in 1919, that's to say 1927, His Majesty Victor Emmanuel III sent his uncle, His Highness the Duke of Abruzzi, to Addis Ababa to return our visit. As soon as he arrived, he informed us of his instruction to discuss with us, since he happened to be on the spot, the question of access to the sea and the construction of a road, but we postponed these talks until the official visit had been completed. It had appeared to us and to all our people that the visit to Addis Ababa of His Highness the Duke of Abruzzi was apt to strengthen greatly the existing friendship with Italy. Therefore, ever since we heard officially about his visit, we prepared a big program suitable for the reception. In particular, we put in hand the building of a new palace in which he was to stay within the precincts of our palace, and it was completed within a brief period. The house was called the Duke's House and used to be known by his name up to the end of the war. When he was about to return to his country at the conclusion of the official visit, he asked to be permitted to speak about the matter to which he had referred, for he had received instructions from his government to give certain information to the Ethiopian government. He then declared as follows: "As my government has heard that you have initiated conversations with the French government with a view to obtaining access to the sea, conversations which have so far remained inconclusive, it is my government's intention to grant a seaport in the Assab area and to construct a motor road from the port to Desi, while the two governments establish a mutual aid company. It is further my government's intention to conclude a treaty of friendship that shall remain in force for 20 years, and I am therefore to inquire as to the wishes of the Ethiopian government. This matter had already been broached previously when you came to Rome in 1916, which is to say 1924. When he explained his government's proposals in these terms, we accepted them as satisfactory, for we would thus obtain, in the first place, an outlet to the sea, and in the second place, a period of 20 years without war in which Ethiopia would work hard and reach a high level. The matter then came before the great princes and nobles, and after it had been approved, we signed the following treaty. Treaty. Whereas it is the desire of the Empress of Ethiopia, Her Majesty Zaudetu, and of the King of Italy, His Majesty Victor Emmanuel III, to consolidate and strengthen further the friendship existing between the two governments and to bring about an expansion of the economic relations between the two countries. Accordingly, His Highness the Farai Mekonnen, heir to the throne and regent plenipotentiary of the Empire of Ethiopia, in the name of Her Majesty Empress Zaudetu, in his own name and that of their successors and Commandant and Commandatore Giuliano Corra, Minister Plenipotentiary of the Royal Italian Government, in the name of His Majesty Victor Emmanuel III and his successors, having reached agreement, have covenanted as follows. First, there shall be everlasting friendship between the Imperial Ethiopian Government and the Royal Italian Government. Second, the two governments have entered into a mutual obligation not to do anything for whatever reason that might affect or damage the independence of the other, and to safeguard and protect their respective interests. Third, the two governments have entered into an obligation to extend and to cause to flourish the trade existing between the two countries. Fourth, Italian native citizens, subjects and protected persons while residing in Ethiopia, and Ethiopians while residing in Italian colonies, as regards their trade and employment, necessities of livelihood and administration, and in anything that concerns the exercise of their professions, their trade and their employment, it is incumbent upon them to observe and to honor the laws of the state in which they are living. Notwithstanding anything stated above, there shall remain applicable to the said Italian subjects and protected persons while resident in Ethiopia the provisions laid down in Article 7 of the treaty between the Emperor of Ethiopia and the Government of the French Republic, concluded on 1st 1900, that's to say 10th January 1908, as long as this treaty remains in force. Fifth, the two governments bind themselves to submit to conciliation or to arbitration judges any matter arising between them on which they cannot agree and which is incapable of being resolved by the customary diplomatic means without recourse to the force of arms. As regards the procedure for selecting arbitrators, the two governments shall exchange notes once they have reached agreement. Sixth, this treaty shall be registered with the League of Nations. The two governments must accept it after ratification. Once proper arrangements have been made, they shall exchange the instruments of ratification at Addis Ababa as soon as possible. Seventh, this treaty shall remain in force for 20 years from the date of ratification. When this period has expired, it shall be renewable annually. This treaty has been written identically in the two official languages, Amharic and Italian, one copy remaining in the hands of the Ethiopian government, the other in the hands of the Italian government. 26th Hamle, 1920, 2nd August, 1928. Later on, in 1921, which is to say 1928-1929, His Highness the Duke of Abruzzi returned to Addis Ababa once more. The reason for his visit was, now that the Treaty of Friendship and Road Construction had been signed, to decorate us with the Grand Order of the Annunziata with golden chain, and then to proceed to Mogadishu, having on the same occasion traversed Arusi and explored from its sources the great river Webi Shebeli, which rises at the meeting point of Arusi and Bale and flows down to Italian Somaliland. The reason why he wanted to see the sources was, according to the version he told me, that he had founded a large concern with a big agricultural enterprise near Mogadishu, and that the water irrigating those plantations was derived from the Webi Shebeli. We sent with him a number of men as guides so that no mishap should befall him throughout his journey. Even though the Duke of Abruzzi was an Italian prince, we had hoped things would turn out in accordance with his assurance, for he had certainly declared repeatedly that the Treaty of Friendship, which had been signed, would remain firm. While we had every intention of observing our treaty obligations and honoring and undertaking after we had concluded the Treaty of Friendship and of the road construction, we spent a lot of money appointing engineers from Holland and set them to survey the direction of the road to Desi. In conjunction with our engineers at Addis Ababa and the people on the spot, after we had completed drawing up the plans and when we were ready to request the Italians that the road works be started, they were not at all intent on the work, but rather on inciting quarrels as of old. They thus delayed matters by dragging their feet and by asking that the work be carried out on their engineers' surveys and calculations, criticizing what our own engineers had done by our way of surveys and measurements. But in Europe, they began to spread the rumor by letting it appear that the Ethiopian government had violated the treaty by postponing the work. Whatever the damage to herself might be, Ethiopia remained from spending her money on press campaigns or from spreading malicious propaganda like Italy, but stuck to the truth firmly. Yet it undoubtedly suited Italy in spreading this sort of report, so to claim that she had to take Ethiopia by war, as the latter was in breach of her treaty obligations. By Italy's own actions, all this has become clearly apparent. Chapter 24, about our receiving the dignity of kingship without ceasing to be heir apparent and regent plenipotentiary. When Ligiasa was removed from the throne on the grounds of his inability to conduct the government, it was arranged that I should take charge and be responsible for the entire business of government, while Queen Zaudetu became empress with myself as heir to the throne and regent plenipotentiary. When by virtue of my office as regent I set to work following the ways of modern civilization, I caused some of the nobles who, to their misfortune, had been hanging on to old customs to give up the plans they had conceived for ruling, just as they pleased the district to which they had been appointed. They began to feel aggrieved when, as those who had been wronged protested, we meted out impartial justice in regard to them, without paying heed to their high station, when we told them to render to the government the income derived from their governorship in terms of customs duties, telephone charges, and similar revenues, and when we moved them about in reshuffles from one province to another, because they were aware in their heart that everything was being done equitably, and that remonstrating would make them objects of shame, they could not openly discuss this matter which caused them such distress. They therefore let this go and decided instead to make Queen Zaudetu an instrument adapted to all their designs. For this purpose, it was Degismach Belcha whom at first they made their leader. It was in a district called Agamja, at a distance of 4 days' march from Addis Ababa, that Duchess Manchibelcha was born. During a military campaign in the Agamja region, he was still a young boy. In the hour of victory, a soldier found him, took him prisoner, and brought him to Emperor Menelik, and he grew up in the palace. It was my father, His Highness Rasmakonin, who became his godfather at the christening. When he was grown up, Emperor Menelik appointed him custodian of all government finances. Later on, when he fought against the Italians at the time of the Battle of Adwa, he showed conspicuous valor and thus began to live in an exalted position. The fact that the Italians killed him now with such cruel violence was additionally an act of revenge for that Battle of Adwa, and not only because he struggled against them in heroic guerrilla actions. While Duchess Manchibelcha occupied a position of rank and honor in Emperor Menelik's time and our own, worthless men who rose up to impede our work seduced him into becoming their leader, and he thus got involved in the matter. But subsequently, when those worthless men were arrested and condemned to punishment, he himself disputed his involvement in the matter, and having escaped the punishment, went to his governorate of Sedamo. As he maltreated the peasants by his mode of governing, and the military by his allocation of quarters, worse even than before, they came to Addis Ababa to complain. When we summoned him to submit to arbitration, he let many months pass before he came, pleading delay or illness or fatigue. After he had turned up, he stayed at his house claiming to be ill, so as not to be called to face arbitration and to appear before the tribunal with those who had been wronged. But as we had heard of his attempts to stir up trouble against us, we had his house surrounded by troops and made him attend by force. When we caused the matter to be investigated, he admitted by his own statement that he had planned to stir up trouble against us, and since his own servants testified against him, he was sentenced in the month of Yekatit, 1920, which is to say February 1928, to be deprived of his office and to reside in a specially designated place. Later on, in the month of Nahase, 1920, that's August 1928, some useless and worthless men rose up against us again, making Duchess Manchibelcha Wekau their leader. Abba Wekau had earlier been a retainer of Emperor Menelik, but after we had become regent plenipotentiary, we nominated him Duchess Manch and made him commander of our guard. But without thinking of his country, Ethiopia, or his honor, the insurgent sought to raise up commotion against us by taking counsel with useless and common people. We heard that he was spreading the rumor, with a view to increasing his following, that it was Queen Zauditu who had ordered him to bring about this upheaval. And when we summoned him to tell us about this in his own words, he bided his time by wandering to and fro within the extensive grounds of the palace precincts. And when it became dark, he entered the Menelik mausoleum adjacent to the palace and stayed there as a rebel. Later on, he sent an intercessor, the Itzchage, and some priest, lest we should impose the death penalty upon him, and then he surrendered. While he was spared the death penalty, he was sentenced to reside at a specified place under arrest. Subsequently, the ministers and nobles living at Addis Ababa, as well as the army commanders and all the men holding office, reached agreement unanimously and declared, "Worthless common people rise up from time to time against our crown prince and create upheaval. Perhaps on some future occasion, when similar disturbances arise, we may fail to prevent internal bloodshed. It is therefore necessary to think of means of restraining such commotion. For this purpose, it is best to act as follows. Emperor Zauditu should have solely the honor of the crown and the throne, as was established when first she succeeded to the reign, leaving the task of government entirely to the crown prince, while the latter should carry out on his sole authority the whole business of government as was defined and initiated on 17th Meskerim 1909, 27th September 1916, without consulting the empress and without obtaining her permission, in order that his authority should possess force and be respected. It would be best for us to arrange that he should attain the dignity of kingship. Once they had decided this, they assembled in the wide square within the palace precincts and approached Emperor Zhaoditu in writing. May it please you to have His Highness Crown Prince Tafari proclaimed king and have him carry out on his sole authority any government business without having to consult anyone. Empress Zhaoditu summoned her special counselors, and when they preferred her advice, it seemed to them an extremely difficult matter. In truth, I myself felt it to be very difficult, for once proclaimed king of some large part of Ethiopia, I could not go there, or else the empress would need another regent. As king, I could scarcely reside at Addis Ababa, for it was not customary for two kings to reside in one city. She therefore sent word to them to be given time in which to ponder the matter. This proposal by the people was awkward not only for Emperor Zhaoditu, but even for myself. I therefore summoned three men from the assembled nobles and dispatched them to the people with this message. It would be good if the idea which you have had that the work of government be accomplished by one man's sole and undivided design could be carried out, but it would be as well if the proposal as regards the kingship were not raised. Arrange for this matter to be dropped, for it might appear that I had incited you in the desire to become king. It is God alone who knows that I am not involved in this affair, but people do not know. They sent word back to us. We cannot go back on it, for the reason we have acted was that we were mindful of the honor of our realm and the benefit and peace of the people. Without favoring anyone, we therefore kept quiet. Later on, when they saw the reply which had reached them from Empress Zhaoditu asking for time to ponder the matter, they presented to her a further written submission, which all of them signed and sealed. The fact that Empress Zhaoditu was asking for time to think about it was simply to obtain time in order to issue a refusal after consultation with their friends who follow her own way of thinking and who do not like modern conditions, or to bring about, on these grounds, a situation in which revolution and civil war would be created. However that may be, their submission ran: we are determined to do what is necessary, being assembled here and not intending to disperse unless you give us the reply today. Moreover, the people of the city did not know the true reason why the ministers, nobles, and army commanders had assembled in the palace grounds, and it needed very little for them to start a revolution. Empress Zhaoditu caused the declaration which had been presented to her with signatures and seals to be read, and when she had understood it, she thought it would be preferable to accept her counsel in order to avoid bloodshed. She then directed that the following written announcement be read out to them. It is my wish that the Crown Prince be crowned as king on a date determined by you on the basis of the advice tendered by you. Consequently, security and calm returned. Thereupon, they pushed each other forward, penetrating as far as the internal courtyard, and clapped hands with joy. Then they conveyed their thanksgiving. Long live Her Majesty the Empress. May Ethiopia live forever. They then went back to their homes. The next morning, they assembled once more and claimed that it would be better for this affair of the kingship to be accomplished within 3 days, lest second thoughts should ruin this matter if further delay were to occur. We convinced them, however, of the impossibility of a thing like kingship being carried out within 2 or 3 days, and furthermore, of the need to inform each of the governments of our neighbors so that their representatives might come and take part in our joy. It was therefore decided that the coronation should take place on the month hence, on 27th Meskerem 1921, which is to say 7th October 1928. As there was rejoicing about Empress Zhaoditu's approval that we were to be proclaimed king, and since the British, French, and Italians who possessed colonies in our neighborhood were delighted, The British government dispatched to Addis Ababa the governor of Berbera, Mr. Kidderminster. The French government sent the governor of Djibouti, Mr. Chapon Baisak, and the Italian government, the governor of Eritrea, Signor Corrado Zoli. When everything that was required for the festival of kingship had been prepared, the whole great ceremony which is enacted for crowning a king of the Ethiopian Empire took place on 27th Meskerem 1921, 7th October 1928. We received the crown from the hands of Empress Zauditu, and the festive day passed off with dignity. Chapter 25, about the instigation by the Italians of Ras Guxawali's rebellion. It is very surprising to observe how the Italians, who were constantly accusing Ethiopia before the League of Nations of being a country without unity, were themselves engaged in propaganda activities with the object of dividing the Ethiopian Empire. It really is astonishing what diligence we had to employ to counteract their propaganda. Yet try as they might, they were unable to bring about internal splits. Things that have occurred quite recently testify to the fact that Italy's idea of waging a war of oppression against Ethiopia goes back a long time. They were disseminating propaganda that caused great damage among our people, yet spreading it about plausibly so to outsiders that Italy was Ethiopia's friend. We do not doubt that all the diplomats residing in Ethiopia are aware of this, and if we were to write about all the propaganda ruses which the Italians have employed against Ethiopia, many pages would be used up, but we would rather leave it. Nevertheless, the work of deceit and propaganda they carried out with the connivance of Ras Guxawali and Ras Hailu is known all over Ethiopia, and it would therefore be improper for us to leave it unrecorded. Ras Guxa was the son of Ras Wale, Empress Taitu's brother. His father, Ras Wale, nominated him Dechismach over a part of his governorate, and later on came to Showa. Ever since Empress Taitu had got married to Emperor Menelik, she had been striving to bring about a rapprochement and much closer relationship of the people of Begamader, Semen, and Yaju, who were her family, with the people of Showa, and she made it her principal purpose to arrange marriages of her female relations with Showan nobles and of her male relations with Showan ladies. She therefore arranged in 1892, that's to say 1899-1900, that Dechismach Guxa, the son of her brother Ras Wale, should marry Emperor Menelik's daughter Waizero Zauditu, subsequently Empress of Ethiopia. On those grounds, he attained the rank of Ras in 1893, that's to say 1900-1901. And when he served as governor of Begamader, Ras Bitwadit Tesama, who became a regent plenipotentiary of the Ethiopian realm after Emperor Menelik's confinement to the palace because of illness, gave the governorship of Begamader to Ras Huelde Gheorghes and directed to Ras Guxa to live in confinement. When Ras Guxa had remained under restriction for about 7 years, Waizero Zauditu was chosen on 17th Meskerem 1909, 27th September 1916, to succeed to the crown and the throne of Ethiopia. When Her Majesty reigned as Empress, she declared, "I shall not live with a husband, but I make a vow to live on my own, for God has selected me, a woman, and has let me live for this great crown and throne." Since she had chosen to live on her own, and as Ras Guxa became aware of the queen's firm resolve, the instrument of their separation was completed by mutual consent, and we assigned to Ras Guxa the governorship of Mbabo in Wayaga and Sayent. But a year later, when the governor of Begamader, King Huelde Gheorghes, died, we restored to Ras Guxa the governorship of Begamader, and for the time being, he was pleased to get his former province back. But the Italians have always been the bane of the Ethiopian people, and some of them, pretending to come for trade or to see the country, went to and fro from Begamader to Asmara, met Rasguksa and went on sowing dissension in his heart, so that in the end they managed to turn his joy into sadness. Worst of all was the fact that the Italian commercial agents resident at Gondar made propaganda his main occupation. The residence of the governor of Begemeder is in the town of Debre Tabor, but the Italians had received permission from Emperor Menelik and from Ligiasu before our time to establish a commercial agency at Gondar, where priests and traders lived and which appeared suitable to them as a base to carry out their propaganda. Afterwards, as Rasguksa Wale possessed a hereditament at a place near Gondar, they presented to him the following proposal in writing. If you lease to us this hereditament of yours, we shall develop your place for you. Afterwards, at the time we leave it, we shall make over to you free of charge any houses we have built there and absolutely everything else. He gave them permission, as it appeared to him a genuine proposal. It was a man called Signor Polera, whom they established as commercial agent at this place. Signor Polera, in order to equip himself for this work of deceit and propaganda, employed an Ethiopian woman for money, and, declaring her his wife, had children by her. Moreover, he was advanced in age, and as is the custom of Ethiopians to show respect for the elderly, all the people of Gondar honored him and did not look upon him as a foreigner. He, on his part, would offer money when a woman had given birth, or at the commemoration for the deceased. Although he was a Catholic, he would enter Orthodox churches and pray as the priests were watching him. On the festival days of the year, he would extend invitations to priests and traders according to the custom of Ethiopian noblemen, and have beer brewed, honey mead prepared, and oxen slaughtered. For all these reasons, he cultivated excellent relations with the local population. Again, he knew that Rasguksa Wale, the governor of Begemeder, was firm in the Orthodox faith and an opponent of European religion and civilization. Therefore, he would go to him and argue thus: it is best for Ethiopia to live according to ancient custom as of old, and it would not profit her to follow European civilization. But it is said that it is the intention of the present Crown Prince and Regent Plenipotentiary to introduce European civilization into Ethiopia. Once European civilization has penetrated Ethiopia, it will inevitably mean freedom of religion. When freedom of religion exists, then the Orthodox faith is bound to weaken and the Catholic faith to strengthen and gradually expand. Thus, it is rumored that the Crown Prince himself is about to join the Catholic religion. Also, we have heard that from time to time he is issuing proclamations aimed at the eradication of slavery from Ethiopia. But now, once all the slaves are declared free, how are those lords and nobles of Begemeder to live? Is it that the masters are to plow with their own hands and the ladies to grind with their own hands? Even in Europe, although slavery has ceased ever since all the work has come to be done by machines, yet in the past every man, like you, had several slaves. Now in this country a great calamity will befall you, unless you and the great nobles, like you, take heed of this. Polera spoke to Rasguksa in those terms, inciting him to rise up himself on his part against us, with the might of his army, while persuading each of the great nobles to do likewise. He assembled his officers and let them into the secret. A friend of mine has advised me in those terms what had best be done. Some of the officers, who were convinced that it was fraudulent advice, sent word to me in secret. But we had no doubt that Rasguksa Wale was planning evil things against our government, as he had listened to the deceitful counsel of the Italians. We therefore bided our time in patience with the intention of clarifying matters. In this affair, it was also thoughtfulness for Emperor Zauditu that impelled us towards patience. Moreover, by sheer coincidence, a contract was awarded at that period to a foreigner, on the part of the Addis Ababa municipality to establish a leather factory at Addis Ababa. Apart from the hides of oxen and goats, he would strip the skin of horses, mules, donkeys, and dogs, and take them to the factory for tanning. When the Italians heard of this, they spread a rumor in every province to the effect that at Addis Ababa, donkeys and dogs were being slaughtered, and a start had been made to feed them to officers and troops at official banquets. It did not seem impossible for a proclamation to be issued all over Ethiopia that the meat of donkeys and dogs was to be eaten in future. The people of Begemeder got a heartfelt shock at this news. In Ethiopia, even people who have only very recently accepted Christianity, leaving aside the people of Begemeder who are of ancient Christian adherence, are known to feel great revulsion when told that the skins of donkeys and dogs are being stripped off for the process of tanning, let alone for eating their meat. Perhaps in Europe too, people are not lacking who feel disgust at things of this sort. Razgook Sawale, although it was with his consent that he was separated from Empress Zauditu, had begun to speak to some of his friends of his grief at being confined to reside in Begemeder only, without being able to come to Addis Ababa at this great time of joy. When the Italians heard this, they realized that this was a suitable time to seduce Razguksa. They told him things which entered deep into his heart, such as, "We are willing to give you the arms you require, and with the aid of the Italian government, you may rebel and fight against the present government, and you may be proclaimed king, and together with Empress Zauditu, you may become the ruler of the whole of Ethiopia." Now, seizing this opportunity, he said that it would be better to die than to abandon our slaves and to live under a government which forces people to eat the meat of donkeys and dogs. He began to endeavor to bring the whole people of Begemeder over to his party and to strengthen the might of his forces. He announced all of this openly in form of a proclamation. "As those of our soldiers who guard the border areas of our empire in the Dankali and Asu provinces, being deserts and places of disease, suffer a great deal. They are permitted occasionally to come up to the highlands for rest." When the Italians received information about this from their spies, they were watching for a moment when the number of troops was diminished, and then sent in army engineers to map the mountains and rivers, valleys, and escarpment. They supplied arms and money to the Wajerat and the Raya and Azabogala, and advised them by every possible ruse to rebel against our government. But some of these Wajerat came and spoke to us while we were in the process of causing it to be investigated whether Italy was doing things of this sort. Oblivious of the treaty of friendship she had concluded with us in 1920, that's to say 1928, we heard that the Wajerat and Raya and Azabogala, flaunting the arms and the money they had received from Italy, were mounting the highlands, killing people and plundering cattle. Therefore, since we knew that Yaju was the district in which Razgook Sawale had grown up, and because of its proximity to Begemeder, we transmitted orders to him to go to Yaju, making amicable appeals to the Wajerat and Azabugala, and offering them friendly advice as well as urging them to abandon their evil works. But if they refused, he was to fight them by military force. We thought, incidentally, that if he now tarried with this mission to Yaju, it would thereby be revealed that everything of which he had been accused, i.e., being in consultation with the Italians, was true. When Razguksa received the order, he mobilized the Begemeder army by proclamation and went to Yaju, so as to let it appear for the moment that he was carrying out orders. But when he had reached Yaju, he heard of his return to Begemeder without accomplishing properly what he had been ordered to do about the Wajerat and Raya and Azabugalas, and that after reaching agreement, they would in fact join him as his support troops. After he had returned, he was chiefly occupied with collecting an army and preparing weapons of war. While we were meaning to be very careful lest the blood of brothers be shed in vain and the desire of the Italians thus be fulfilled. We sent word to Rasgupta suggesting that we should at any rate meet at Warayelu and discuss in detail the reason why he had returned from the military expedition as well as every other matter. Thereafter, he might go back. While he wrote back merely words of deceit, claiming to agree and to set out at once, we received information that, in fact, he was tarrying and preparing for war. We therefore dispatched troops under the command of Decesmach Mulugeta, who were to keep watch, being stationed at Huatla and Delenta, in order to prevent Rasgupta slipping into Yaju and linking up with the Wajirat and Raya Azabugala. As Italy's propaganda agents were seeking out some magicians and dreamers who are to be encountered in Begemeder, they sent them to Rasgupta, instigating them to speak to him encouragingly. The time has come for you to be king. Hence, have courage and do not fear. Proof of all this was discovered in Rasgupta's portfolio, which was captured in the war. Since some Ethiopians do not possess, apart from religious knowledge, any other education in secular politics, thus, when monks or hermits tell them that at a certain time a certain thing will take place, they accept it as true, for it seems to them that such men were sent by God. To profit by this, the Italians, since they are acquainted with this fact, make it their chief instrument. Anxious to ascertain the Italians' involvement or non-involvement in this affair, we spoke to the Italian minister at Addis Ababa. Sell us one airplane for the preservation of internal security, and we shall appoint a pilot from among your people. He told us that he would inform his government and convey the reply as soon as possible, but he delayed giving us any answer. And when there was just one day left before Rasgupta's attack upon our army, the minister let us know that they had not succeeded in sending the aircraft from Asmara immediately, since in our heart we had known all along that the reply would be thus. It caused us no surprise whatsoever. Having been deceived by lies of this sort, Rasgupta decided to make war. He issued a proclamation of mobilization, marched along in a great hurry, and on 22nd Megabit 1922, 31st March 1930, launched an attack upon Decesmach Mulugeta at Kwana. When he had fought for about 3 hours, he suffered a defeat. Thus, the deceitful council over which the Italians had toiled for so many years was demolished in 3 hours, and Rasgupta came to his end. The fact that the majority of the captured arms found in the hands of Rasgupta's troops in the course of this battle were Veterli rifles, which had come from Asmara, made it quite certain to us that it was the Italians who had helped Rasgupta to rebel. The Empress Zauditu died on 24th Megabit 1922, 2nd April 1930, 2 days after the death of Rasgupta. Empress Zauditu had for a long time prior to this suffered from diabetes, which had been diagnosed by the Swedish doctor Hanner and the Swiss doctor Mayberg. As this disease got progressively worse and more virulent every year, she had latterly been very ill. Therefore, she had not been informed of Rasgupta's death, lest this news should aggravate her illness. This was because the physicians who were treating her, Dr. Hanner and Dr. Mayberg, had given instructions that she was not to hear the sad news, but the Italians, when the intention of completing the full measure of their deceitfulness, spread the rumor that she died of shock after having heard the news, while in fact there is no prince, noble, or minister at Addis Ababa who does not know that Empress Zauditu died without hearing of Rasgupta's death in battle. Chapter 26, about our planning and initiating gradual improvements and reforms in the work of the clergy. Since time immemorial, the kings of Ethiopia, just as they were responsible for the entire business of government, were also in charge of the affairs of the church. They would select persons from among the savants and the learned and make appointments to, as well as dismissals from, office at the various churches and monasteries, and in general have the authority to control all their functions. But with the gradual increase in government business and the occasional waging of wars against the pagans in neighboring countries, they simply did not have the time to control in full the affairs of the church. Consequently, there were many things detrimental to the ordinances of the church, which had in error penetrated into the community of the clergy and had by custom persisted. But now that we had established a constitution and had introduced a legal framework into each ministry, and had also arranged for ministers to carry out their respective functions with full responsibility, we brought about a progressive and step-by-step improvement in the work of the clergy, as we were meeting church leaders and priors in the time left over from affairs of state. These improvements were as follows. 1. Since the people of Ethiopia, great and small, men and women, were firm in their Christianity, they went to church and heard Mass each week on Sunday and on each of the great festivals. Whoever was able to would receive the Eucharist. But as Holy Mass was in the Gittis language, which not all the people could understand, many would return home without comprehending the words explaining the mysteries, just listening to the sound of the chants. But now we arranged for the Holy Mass to be translated into Amharic and to be printed. And once it had been distributed in every church, the people began to understand when the text was read out in their own language, even if not all of it, then at least the main part. It was likewise arranged for the Gospels, Acts of the Apostles, and Epistles to be read to them in Amharic. 2. With a view of bringing about a cessation of the quarrels which flare up from time to time as regards their livelihood between deans, priests, and church custodians or abbots, monks and adjuvants who live in the various large churches and monasteries, we assembled the savants and the learned and made them bring along the ancient customs and rules of life of each of the churches and monasteries. By getting them to set up new and improved regulations, great benefit was attained. Improved and newly established, the regulations are to be found at Zikbala, Debra Libanos, Jerusalem, and all other monasteries. 3. The fact that there is to be found in each church a copy of the Metzhafe Taklil constitutes proof of the exercise of the existence in Ethiopia in earlier times of a crowning ceremony at the marriage service. However, the ceremonial of the church was progressively diminished, and therefore marriage by crowning was not very widespread, not even among the clergy, let alone among the people. But it is not known whether this happened at the time of the uprising of Ahmad Gran or during the extermination of Christians when Yodit of the Falasha tribe reigned. Nonetheless, there were many among the clergy and the people who were strengthening their marriage by receiving Eucharist together with their spouses. But now we have urged the savants and the learned to preach exalting marriage by crowning, and as a result, it has again become customary. 4. In earlier times, when a person died, his family, in arranging the Taskar memorial service, would prepare tala, beer, tej, honeymead, and other intoxicating matter, and would invite the priest to the house of the deceased. They would offer them food and drink beyond measure, and would make them exceed what has been ordained. But now, since we have become convinced that conduct of this kind does not conform to the new era of civilization, and is also forbidden by the Holy Scriptures, we have arranged that the taskar should cease consisting of intoxicating drink and excessive amounts of food, and that instead the relatives of the deceased should have the absolution prayers performed and give, according to their means, some money to the priest for the performance of absolution. It should not, however, be forbidden to offer food and drink to the poor, provided this is done in moderation. We also urged the bishops and priors to preach in this sense, intending to be a model and example to the people. When our daughter Princess Zeneba Werk died, we distributed gifts of money for the absolution rites among various churches and monasteries. Many people then began to do likewise. 5. Since early times, it was the custom in some provinces for some of the relatives of a deceased person to manifest mourning by cutting their hair, beating their breast, and by general wailing. But now, we have given instructions to the savants to go around the various churches and to pray, to preach that the family of the deceased should, apart from wearing a black patch on the edge of their dress as a sign of mourning, cease the cutting of hair, the beating of breast, and wearing special mourning clothes. Hence, as the savants preached with diligence, the hopeless mourning for a dead person has gradually eased. 6. As we were convinced that we had the responsibility to protect the church and to see that the laws given to her were firmly kept, lest her faith be shaken, we granted one day each week on which the savants and doctors might approach us and draw attention, personally, to all the difficulties of the church. Consequently, the problems of the church gradually eased. Apart from this, while regulations have been drafted, the following matters have, for the time being, remained in abeyance. In Ethiopia, the number of priests is very large. To all of these, the government has allocated as rest land individually in each province, from one half to one gasha of land, i.e., approximately 40 to 80 acres. This land, having been assigned as hereditary, passes on to children's children, and, therefore, the church is unable to make provisions with regard to it. Furthermore, beginning with the emperor, princes, noblemen, and all others like them, not even ladies excluded, could assume the duties of the church wardens, and in that case the emperor used to allocate to them hereditary land of between 200 and 700 gashas. It was our intention, however, to bring about a situation where hereditary land should cease to belong to individuals by virtue of this church wardenship, but should become that of the church, that the deans of churches should allocate from the income of these properties adequate amounts to the priests, deacons, choristers, and readers for their livelihood. As regards any surplus, the deans of churches should build, after proper consultations and with the governments helping them over any deficit that might arise, schools and hospitals, homes for the aged, and educational establishments for the children of the poor. As it would take us a long time to have these ideas of ours carried out in the churches all over Ethiopia, we arranged to make a start by demonstrating the usefulness of the scheme and its working method in the monasteries of Zikwala, Addis Alam, and Asabot, as well as the churches of Addis Ababa and in the Menelik II Mausoleum Church. Chapter 27, about our arrangements for the appointment of bishops chosen from among the savants of Ethiopia. It does not appear to us likely that anyone doubts that Ethiopia, besides being a large country, has lived steadfast in her Christianity from the 4th century up to the present time, some 1600 years. In any event, one can be easily convinced of this fact by reading Ethiopia's history. But when Ethiopia accepted Christianity, the seat of government and the principal city of the realm were at Aksum. Consequently, it was to that province of Aksum that one bishop only was appointed by the archbishop, who was the incumbent of the see of St. Mark at Alexandria. When he died, another would be substituted, but never were there appointed several bishops in accordance with the size of the country. Recently, in 1864, that is to say 1872, during the reign of Emperor Johannes, 4 Coptic, i.e. Egyptian, bishops had been appointed and eventually arrived in 1873, that's to say 1880-1881. The reason was that Emperor Johannes, having enthroned King Menelik over Shoah, the king, and King Teklehaimanot over Gojam, had intended to install his son Ras Araya as king of Begemeder. He was then to retain one bishop for himself for the Tigray province and to distribute 3 bishops to the 3 kings. But the 4th bishop died before reaching Aksum, while Ras Araya died before becoming king, so the emperor divided Ethiopia into 3 dioceses and assigned them to each of the 3 bishops. Thus the clergy were relieved of a tiring journey to a distant province, where the one single bishop presided, in order to receive ordination as priest or deacon,
When two of these three bishops died and were not replaced by others, there only remained Abuna Mateus for the whole of Ethiopia. And as his residence was in the capital Addis Ababa, members of the clergy who came from the various provinces of Ethiopia to receive the office of priest or deacon encountered great inconveniences and lived in a state of some turmoil. As we were aware of the great difficulties encountered by members of the clergy in this matter, we set down this our opinion in writing, with proper documentary support, to say that bishops should be appointed from among the savants of the country to tour their diocese, preaching and conferring the priesthood and deaconship. This was dispatched with the seal of Empress Auditu and at my own to the Orthodox Patriarch Abuna Yohannes at Alexandria. After Abuna Yohannes had examined the matter with his lucid mind, he was convinced that this was a proper request and consequently sent to us the following reply. If you choose five from among the Ethiopian savants and send them to us. After Abuna Yohannes had examined the matter with his lucid mind, he was convinced that this was a proper request and consequently sent to us the following reply. If you choose five from among the Ethiopian savants and send them to us, it is our intention to appoint them as bishops. We shall, however, additionally dispatch a Coptic Egyptian bishop who shall be primus among the Ethiopian bishops, and may you please appreciate this. When we informed the princes, nobles, doctors, and savants of this, the majority received the matter with joy. But some members of the clergy, although unable to oppose our view openly, did not stop trying. This was not because they had investigated the matter thoroughly and understood it, but it arose from their subjugation to custom. However, in the course of time, we succeeded in convincing them that it would confer great honor upon the Church of Ethiopia if this proposal were carried out. They therefore informed us that they had changed their previous view and assured us of the acceptance of our plan. Subsequently, Mamher Desta, Mamher Haila Mariam, Memher Weldekidan, and Memher Haila Mikael were selected, and we arranged for them to go to Egypt in the month of Gembot 1921, which is to say May, June 1929. Meanwhile, the Patriarch Abuna Yohannes was waiting, having selected Abuna Kerrios from among the monks of the monastery of Asketis, whom he was sending as head of the Ethiopian bishops, and as soon as the Ethiopian savants reached Cairo, he immediately and without delay appointed the five of them together as bishops, i.e. on the 25th Gembot, 2nd June. He, the patriarch, assigned to them the following names: Memher Desta to Abuna Abraham, Memher Haile Mariam to be Abuna Petros, Memher Weldekidan to be Abuna Yesehak, Memher Haila Mikael to be Abuna Mikael. Abuna Petros was the bishop who died in martyrdom at the hands of the Italians when he was captured in Hamle 1928, which is to say July 1936, preaching about Ethiopia's freedom. Abuna Mikael was battered to a martyr's death at the hands of the enemy in the town of Gore. After the bishops had been appointed to their episcopal office, they returned to Ethiopia together with the Archbishop Abuna Kerrios. Since we were convinced that this was an unprecedented event in Ethiopia, glorifying the Ethiopian Church, we arranged that upon their arrival at Addis Ababa, the princes and nobles, doctors and savants, as well as the priests of the various churches, should assemble in Masse. Cannons were fired and a ceremonial welcome was held in their honor. Thereupon, because we meant them to begin their work of education by touring their respective dioceses, we made the following dispositions. The diocese of Archbishop Abuna Kerrios is to include the whole of Shoa, the district surrounding Addis Ababa, and added to this Harar and Arusi. For Abuna Abraham, Gojam and Beket Meder. For Abuna Yesehak, Tigre, Lasta, and Wag, and all the surrounding districts. For Abuna Petros, the entire provinces of Walo and Yaju. for Abuna Mikael. The area is called Kafa, Elubabor, Walega, and the whole of western Ethiopia. The man who had been selected to be the sixth bishop was Itzchage Gebre Menfesk Edus of Debre Libanos, but as it had been permanently inconvenient for him to travel to Egypt with the savants, it was his good fortune that later on, in Tachsas 1922, that's to say December or January 1929-1930, the patriarch Abuna Yohannes came to Addis Ababa to visit his children in the faith and immediately bestowed the rank of bishop upon Itzchage Gebre Menfesk Edus and named him Abuna Sawiros. We assigned to him as his diocese the whole of southern Ethiopia. It was wonderful that at this time, God in his charity wrought two great works of good fortune for the Ethiopian church. One, the appointment of men chosen from among Ethiopia's own savants to the office of bishop, something that had never happened in some 1600 years from the time Ethiopia accepted Christianity in the 4th century up to the present. 2. The journey to Addis Ababa of the Patriarch Abuna Yohannes, his celebrating Mass in an Ethiopian church, and his blessing of the people, while at the same time appointing the Itzchage of Debre Libanos to the dignity of a bishop. Chapter 28. About our coronation as emperor. On the 17th of Meskerem 1909, that is 27th September 1916, I was chosen heir to the throne and regent, with Queen Zauditu occupying the throne, and when I had patiently carried out the work of government for 14 years in my office of regent plenipotentiary, Queen Zauditu died on 24th Megabit 1922, that is 2nd April 1930, and consequently on the morrow I was proclaimed emperor and assumed the throne. As regards the succession to the throne and crown, we have read in history that at a time when Ethiopia lived in isolation and before she had established relations with foreign countries, the prevailing custom had been, at the demise of the emperor for his death, often to remain carefully unannounced. They would then place his son and heir on the throne and crown him immediately that very day. Only after the son's reign and coronation had been announced by proclamation would they give a ceremonial burial to the dead king. At other times, again, at the demise of the emperor, the officers of the royal household would take him clandestinely and bury him before anyone could hear about it, and on the morrow they would place his son and heir on the throne. After they had conducted the royal installation service and crowned him, the death of the father and the new reign of the son would be announced by proclamation at the same time. But now that Ethiopia had concluded treaties of commerce and friendship with 12 foreign governments, had entered the League of Nations, and had established firm friendly relations, we were convinced that it was proper, in accordance with the practice of the most civilized governments, in the case of their coronations, to invite to our coronation the countries which had set up legations and consulates in Ethiopia. But as it would require a long time to dispatch the letters of invitation and to await the arrival of the delegates, as well as to make all the necessary preparations for the coronation, we arranged for the ceremony to be postponed for 7 months. After this, letters of invitation were written and dispatched to the kings and presidents, whose names follow here: to His Majesty George V, King of England, Emperor of India; to His Majesty Victor Emmanuel III, King of Italy; to His Majesty Hirohito, Emperor of Japan; to His Majesty Albert II, King of Belgium; to His Majesty Gustav V, King of Sweden; to Her Majesty Wilhelmina, Queen of Holland; to His Majesty Fuad I, King of Egypt; to H.E.M. Damerghe, President of the French Republic; to H.E. Field Marshal von Hindenburg, President of the German Republic; to H.E. Mustafa Kemal Pasha, President of the Turkish Republic; to H.E.M. Kodoriotis, President of the Greek Republic; and to H.E. Mr. Hoover, President of the United States of America. Furthermore, the Polish government had initiated conversations to conclude a treaty of commerce and friendship with the Ethiopian government, but by the time our coronation day came, these negotiations were still not completed. The Poles then demonstrated their goodwill by declaring, Although the treaty is not yet signed, we shall send an envoy to the coronation, since we have mutually manifested our thoughts of friendship. We therefore informed the President M. Mosik that it was our intention to receive their envoy with great pleasure. This mark of friendship with the Polish government had shown us at that time remained forever engraved in our heart. Again, as we have explained before, since in earlier times the coronation was held on the very day the son and heir ascended the throne, there was no time to invite the princes and nobles of each region. But now that we had arranged for our coronation to be postponed for 7 months, letters of invitation were sent all over Ethiopia to princes and nobles and all the headmen, the priors of the monasteries, and the deans of cathedrals, that they should come and participate in our joy. A letter of invitation was also written to Abba Amda Mariam, the prior of Debrecen, which had remained well known and esteemed in its importance from early times when the kings of Ethiopia had consecrated it as a monastery, although today it is within the Italian colony of Eritrea. As the following months were part of the rainy season, instructions were transmitted to all to stay put in order to prepare for the journey, to set out at the end of the month of Meskerem, early October, when the rainy season had passed, and to reach Addis Ababa towards the 20th of Tekemt, 30th October. After these invitations had been dispatched to the foreign governments and to the great within Ethiopia, arrangements were made for the principal streets of Addis Ababa and the houses along each street to be repaired, as well as for electric light to be installed along the main streets and in all the houses by which the guest would pass. The imperial vestments, the crown and the orb, the imperial scepter and the sword, the ring and all similar things were specially made of gold and diamonds. Formerly, the only distinctive mark of honor for princes had been their golden headgear, but now we arranged that the golden headgear should be for Rhasis, who had been appointed by virtue of hard work and services, while the crown prince and for princes of royal descent, we had made a pearl-studded headgear, coronet, smaller than a crown but excelling the golden headgear in size and in beauty of workmanship. For the ladies of our family and the wives of princes, golden diadems smaller than those for princes and corresponding to their rank. For military commanders, i.e. for Dejus Magus, vestments and headgear were made of lion's manes that were interlaced with gold and embroidered with velvet. Furthermore, gold medals were manufactured in large quantities on which the effigies of myself and Empress Menen were engraved together, on which were to be given as souvenirs to foreign guests coming to our coronation, either by invitation or of their own volition, as well as to notables and important persons from within the country. Subsequently, between Tekemt 8th and 20th, i.e. October 18th and 30th, the foreign envoys who had been invited began to arrive at Addis Ababa, each in his turn. Here follow the names of the envoys. HRH, the Duke of Gloucester, envoy of His Majesty the King of England. HRH, the Prince of Udine, envoy of His Majesty the King of Italy. H.E.M. Gerard, envoy of His Majesty the King of the Belgians. H.E. Baron H.K.C. Bildete, envoy of His Majesty the Queen of Sweden. H.E. Jonkheer Hendrik Maurits van Heersma de Witt, envoy of Her Majesty Queen of the Netherlands. H.E.M. Isaburo Yoshida, envoy of His Majesty the Emperor of Japan. H.E. Mohammed Taufik Nassim Pasha, envoy of His Majesty the King of Egypt. H.E. Marshal Franchet de Esperi, envoy of the French Republic. H.E. Mr. H.M. Jacobi, envoy of the USA. H.E. Baron von Waldetausen, envoy of the German Republic. H.E. Count P. Metaxa, envoy of the Greek Republic. H.E. Mahutin Pasha, envoy of the Turkish Republic. H.E. Count Deziduski, envoy of the Polish Republic. All these guests expressed to us their pleasure at the ceremonial reception which we arranged for them upon their arrival. Furthermore, we had caused to be set up in the vicinity of the Royal Church of St. George, a statue of the great Emperor Menelik II. The work was eventually completed, and it was then determined that it should be inaugurated on the eve of the coronation. Consequently, after all the guests who had come for our coronation had arrived with much ceremonial to be present thereat, we made a lengthy speech explaining the propriety of erecting a statue to Menelik II. When we had finished, we gave the honor of uncovering the veil with which the statue had been wrapped to HRH, the Duke of Gloucester. He approached the monument, removed the curtain, and when the statue was seen, the joy in the hearts of Ethiopians was inestimable. On this day, towards evening, the Becheron treasurer placed the imperial state vestments and the crown, the orb, the imperial scepter and sword, and the diamond ring, as well as the emperor's state robes and crown and diamond ring, on a chariot and took it in a great parade to the Royal Church of St. George, where he consigned it to the archbishop, and where it remained all night to be prayed over. We and the empress, our family and princess and nobles went to the church at midnight. It had been arranged that our foreign guest should only arrive at 7 o'clock in the morning, and they then took their seats, which had been prepared on the right and on the left of the throne, according to their rank. The seating order provided that Ethiopian princes and nobles should be interspread among the foreign guests. Before the Sir'at Negus, the royal ritual, began, the Archbishop Abuna Kerrios approached with a gospel bound in gold and asked us to complete the following words of the oath. 1. That we should strengthen the Orthodox faith which had remained steadfast in Ethiopia from the days of the holy kings Abraha and Asbeha, and that we should keep without disturbance the laws and ordinances which the Orthodox Church has laid down. 2. That in all we are doing, by our authority and our power to the people in the imperial realm of Ethiopia, we should act with consideration for the interest of the people according to law, as well as with kindness and with patience. 3. That we would permanently maintain the laws we had established after submitting them of our own free will to the council for advice, and that we would safeguard the entire Ethiopian realm and people in accordance with established law and the ordinances of the council. 4. That we would assist by our goodwill and authority the establishment of schools at which secular and spiritual education would be developed in Ethiopia, in which the Gospels would be preached. After we had completed the swearing-in ceremony, affirming our willingness to maintain all that is laid down above, we appended our signature thereto. Subsequently, the Archbishop assigned to the 6 bishops their respective functions in the coronation service, and then prayers were begun. Of these bishops, 5 were Ethiopian. The 6th was Abuna Yosab, who had come from Egypt as the envoy of the Patriarch of Alexandria, Abuna Yohannes, to partake in the joy of our coronation and to convey his blessing. After the Archbishop and bishops had completed the service, performing readings and prayers with the choir singing, the Archbishop approached and anointed us with the oil of kingship and placed the imperial crown on us. At this moment, our heir to the throne, His Highness Asfaw Wilson, removed the coronet from his head, and when he knelt before us, the Archbishop approached with the gospel and asked him to take the following oath. 1. That he would honor his father with his whole heart and be obedient to him. 2. That he would not seek in association with evil men what we had not given him or of our own will. 3. That he would keep the laws which we had established after referring them of our own free will to the council for advice. After he had sworn to fulfill this, he appended his signature to it. Subsequently, the coronation service of the Empress commenced. The procedure for the enthronement of the Empress is today very different from what it used to be previously. According to our historical study of the earlier practice, the Empress was not anointed with the oil of kingship on the grounds that she did not share in rulership with the Emperor. The crown, being merely symbolic, was very small. It was in the palace that the emperor placed the crown on her head and not in church. This occurred on the third day, for it was not permitted for her to be crowned on the same day as the emperor, but now it was determined after consultation and was accordingly carried out, that except for the regal anointing, the archbishop should place the crown on her and put the diamond ring on her finger, and that this should be on the same day jointly with the coronation of the emperor. Chapter 29, about our setting up a constitution. In former times, when kings ruled the people according to their own will, be it in Europe, Asia, or Africa, there used to be a good deal of upheaval and divergence between the kings and the people, as well as members of the royal family. The history of the governance of many countries demonstrates this. In our country, in Ethiopia, it used to be done likewise. We had, therefore, been contemplating the promulgation of a constitution for our reign, to bequeath to our heirs a form of rule that is based on law, and to bring our people into partnership in the work of government. In fact, while we were still crown prince and regent plenipotentiary of the Ethiopian realm, we had told Queen Zauditu that it would be of great benefit to the government and the people if a constitution were established. But some of the great nobles, to whose advantage it was to rule the country without a constitution, had presented that it would diminish the dignity and authority of the Queen Zauditu if a constitution were set up. For this reason, our plan had remained unfulfilled. At that time, although we were regent plenipotentiary, there were complex circumstances involved. Before tackling any major affairs, I used to inform Her Majesty Empress Zauditu. If she accepted the matter, I arranged for it to be carried out at once. Yet, if she did not approve, I did not wish to upset her and do things by force, insisting that I was regent plenipotentiary, but rather to convince her by repeatedly reverting to the matter. This arose from the consideration that it was necessary to be careful lest disturbances or bloodshed should occur in the country. Hence, I patiently delayed the establishment of a constitution. But after the death of Queen Zauditu on 24th Megabit 1922, that is 2nd April 1930, we inherited crown and throne by due process of law, and therefore decided to set up the constitution we had planned earlier on during our regency. Hence we examined the constitution of various countries and chose people who possessed experience and knowledge of foreign countries, as well as those versed in the customs and early history of each province inside the country, and commanded them to select and extract from the constitutions of foreign countries what was appropriate for the Ethiopian people, and then submit recommendations to us. When these had been set down in writing and had been presented, we examined them and then gave orders to the following persons to make a joint study and to submit them prepared for signature. From among the nobles, Ras Kasa Hailu, Ras Hailu Tekle Haimanot, Ras Siyu Mengesha, Ras Guksa Araya, Ras Imruhayala Selassie. From among ministers, the Minister of War Fetaurari Beru Welde Gebreal, the Minister of Interior Betwadit Welde Tzedek Goshu, from Foreign Minister Blatangeta Herui Welde Selassie, the Minister of the Pen Tsehafe Tizas Welde Miskel Tariku, from among officials Dejismach Yigazu Behabte Becherontekle Haimenot Hawariat. These men, who had been instructed to investigate the matter and then to present it ready for signature, had remained disunited in their views and had, therefore, spent a great deal of time arguing in our presence. Ras Emru alone among the nobles had shared the opinion of the ministers and officials, while the remaining four nobles were united among themselves in a rather different view. The opinion of the nobles was that Ethiopia, having been divided into various large provinces, each should be given as hereditary property to the nobles passing on from generation to generation, that their descendants should not be disinherited unless it were proved against them that they had committed some serious criminal act against the emperor or the government, that the provincial landowners within their domain, having the region they hold recognized as their hereditary property, should continue to pay taxes to the nobles and remain subservient to them. In general, this connotes a feudal form of government. But the opinion of the ministers and officials was as follows. If Ethiopia, divided into its respective large provinces, were given as hereditary property to the nobles and landowners, passing on from generation to generation, and if it were claimed that appointments were limited to their descendants, how was there to be a rising generation in the future? If a man had studied and given service and yet does not obtain office or an administrative appointment, how can he say, Ethiopia is my country? Therefore, let the present nobles and landowners, unless some wrongdoing is proved against them, stay on in their office of governor only. But if they are dismissed for some misdemeanor or die, then let any Ethiopian who possess the knowledge and ability be appointed to their governorship. For exclusive succession within the family is not a proper procedure. But if their sons are found to be like other men in knowledge and in service, then let the emperor in his wisdom appoint them to their father's governorship or other post of rank. Yet it does not appear to us proper for it to be laid down in the constitution that their governorship should pass from father to son as hereditary property. When the nobles saw that the ministers and officials did not accept the opinion they had submitted, they put forward as an alternative the following plan, under which it would be laid down in the constitution that some districts only, out of the many within their governorships, would pass on as hereditary. But the ministers and officials refused to accept this view and remained steadfast in their earlier opinion. When we heard that the men whom we had selected for this task remained divided in their opinions, we arranged that both sides should submit their proposals together with supporting evidence in writing. After we had examined the matter, we decided as follows. The emperor may assign hereditary land rights and land held as a fief, either to nobles or to other servants of the realm. A paragraph to this effect is to be written into the constitution, and in future things are to be arranged as required, having regard to their service. But, so we explained to the nobles, it was no longer proper that, since we were aware that feudal rule had ceased in the world, we should now once again reaffirm it, either having it laid down in the constitution of governing without a constitution. Once matters had been clarified, they were to be written down and prepared for signature. Afterwards, we arranged for nobles and ministers, army commanders and provincial governors, chiefs, bishops, and savants for all to assemble at an important ceremony. Then the constitution, which had been prepared for signature, was read out to them, and all affirmed their view with one voice. We like it. Let it be set up. Nevertheless, in Ethiopia, for some 3,000 years since the days of Menelik I, the customary method of rule was not a king who governed by a constitution, having set up a parliament, but an emperor who governed by his own authority alone. Some men who were our particular friends did not understand the matter, and therefore they advised me with sincerity as follows. How can you, by your own action, hand over to the people your authority of government? Please cause this to be stopped. When I explained things to them to the best of my ability, they accepted the argument. When the ninth day of Hamlin 1923, that is 16th July 1931, was fixed as the date for the signing of the constitution and the promulgation of the decree, we gave orders to our minister of the pen to inform the senior officials and to our foreign minister to notify the foreign diplomats. The foreign diplomats arrived with great pomp at 4 o'clock, that's to say 10 a.m., on the appointment day, and stood by their seats according to their rank. We then made the following speech explaining the reason why we had thought it right to establish a constitution. We were thinking that it was not enough for us to thank our Lord with words alone for the trust we had received from God to guard Ethiopia and for granting us this high rank of emperor. Nor was it sufficient to appease him with minor deeds and with what was of benefit to ourselves only. Although we were striving to set up a constitution that was of benefit extending to everybody, enduring forever and being transmitted from generation to generation, this was still not enough to repay the Lord's favor. Because we wish to reveal to you our intention of entrusting to God the fulfillment of the task we had begun, we have assembled you here at this hour in a great gathering. Nobody will fail to appreciate the law. That law is the greatest benefit to every man. It is from the equity of law that honor and advantage arise. It is from the deficiency of law that distress and damage result. It is through failure to set up law that violence and injury grow. While God, being above every creature, would not find it difficult to issue orders by his word alone, yet his instituting law is because he knew that the law should be the supreme ruler of the whole world. He who merits being called just among men, in whatever sphere it might be, is the person who strives and endeavors by the knowledge given to him to benefit the majority, even though not all mankind as a whole, when pursuing his principal aims. Although for a number of reasons our plan had been delayed in its execution, our entire endeavor, which we had initiated a long time ago, had been to set up a framework of law for the state. Therefore, our idea, which we pursued steadfastly and which we formulated for Ethiopia and our beloved people, is to declare to you now, first, our granting a constitution to the Ethiopian people, and secondly, our wish to follow this law meticulously and to maintain it. In this constitution which we are giving to the Ethiopian people, the principal ideas formulated in it are the following. 1. It is to bring about that Ethiopia, being one family undivided by sections, the people shall live in unity, controlled by one law and governed by one emperor, and that this power of unity shall be safeguarded by the interest which bind them permanently together, and while the interest of individuals shall not be abandoned, the strength of the united community shall be paramount, without sacrificing the benefits due to individuals or oneself. One is not to seek divisive private interest. 2. The law, in its function of conferring advantage or punishment, shall be equitable without showing favor to whomever it may be. 3. By virtue of the fact that in past times the people of Ethiopia remained cut off from other countries and were therefore unable to secure the advantages which the great civilizations of today confer, as well as by virtue of adhering to their own age-old civilization, the kings of Ethiopia, being like good fathers to the people, continued carrying on their work of administration. But now, since our people has progressively advanced in whatever sphere to a higher level of civilization, time has permitted us to establish a constitution and to bring the people into partnership in our toil, so as to accomplish the heavy task of government with which earlier kings have had to struggle on their own. It is necessary that at the present time the Ethiopian people should join in all the work of the government. We have therefore set up two chambers of parliament, so that all persons suitable, qualified for this task, should become participants in the work. The counselors who tender advice in these chambers shall come from each province, being chosen by the emperor's authority until the people are able to hold elections on the basis of education and knowledge. The advice to be decided by majority voting will come into force when it has been approved by the emperor. 4. Once advice has been tendered by parliament and been approved by the emperor, it is the responsibility of ministers to apply it to the whole of Ethiopia and to carry on the affairs of the government and the people. 5. Lest disturbances should break out and cause harm to Ethiopia, it has been determined by law that the Ethiopian imperial dignity shall not at any time secede from the dynasty in respect of which it has been written into its constitution. 6. The need for law arises so that any condition of life, as it is being improved, shall be on a well-ordered and trustworthy basis, for it is knowledge that ameliorates and moderates everything, so that the administration of Ethiopia in whatever sphere shall be led towards knowledge. It is right that we should always seek the selective acceptance of all knowledge in its various kinds. 7. This constitution which we have established is not just idle fiction or discordant with the country's customs, for it closely approaches that of the civilized and educated nations. In its preparation, we had the help and ideas of other nobles and other officials of other Ethiopian subjects whom we had chosen for their relevant knowledge. Man makes a beginning, but it is God alone who has the power to accomplish things. We place our trust in God that he may grant us to bring into effect this constitution which we have set up. Your excellencies, foreign envoys, and consuls, we thank you for having come to share our joy and to honor with us this fortunate day on which we have established and signed the constitution. When we had finished this speech, our minister of the pen read out the following text of the proclamation. Having been chosen to the imperial dignity of Ethiopia by God's goodness and the people's united accord, acting under the law and preserving the trust which we have received from God, when we were anointed on accepting, by due process of law, the crown and the throne, we have brought about that our successors should take over from us by lawful means and operate within the legal framework, establishing regulations by which he will give protection to our country in honest administration under the law. We have chosen to set up a constitution explaining and expounding our ideas because we were hoping to cause pleasure and to contribute to Ethiopia's prosperity, to the strength of our government, and to the profit and benefit of our beloved people. The basis upon which the Ethiopian realm is to be firmly placed in future and which justifies the establishment of a constitution requires a trusty safeguard, so that the condition of our state shall forever be stable and firm. It being well known how this is determined by the law upon which this foundation rests and by the strength with which the law is applied. For this reason, ever since we have occupied the imperial throne of Ethiopia and received this great trust from the hand of God, we have recognized the duty to decree and to employ means by which our realm will be strengthened, the standard of living of our people be improved, and our population be led on the road to higher civilization and enjoyment by which they will obtain all the good things which the free and civilized nations have achieved. The most productive thing necessary to effect this, we have recognized, is to have the entire work of government well organized. After clarifying the need for a future constitution to ensure an enjoyable standard of living for the people and to have the state exist in peace and security by which honor will be attained that passes from one generation to another. As it was our lofty idea to bring our realm to the highest level in its long history, we have established by decree this constitution of our own free will, without being requested by anyone, in the second year of our reign in 1923, that is 1931, when occupying the imperial throne. Subsequently, the constitution, which had been prepared in writing, was presented, and after we had signed it first, then beginning with our heir to the throne, the bishops and princes, ministers and notables and officials, all appended their signatures to it. The foreign diplomatic envoys signed for the sake of a memento, writing their names in a specially prepared register.